A vigorous good evening to one and all who are present here on the session today on this auspicious evening of Onam. Onam is a festival of flowers. Onam is a festival of goat race. Onam is a festival of tiger race. And also, Onam speaks of equanimity. On this note of equanimity, today, I, Rajatyam, a student of University Law College, start this. I myself feel very proud for having got this opportunity of hosting this event. Today, we are hosting the 14th special lecture series of ULC, where we are proud enough to continue this ongoing record of conducting all the series of webinars and special lecture series under our able, under the able guardianship and stewardship of our Honorable Professor Dr. V. Suresh V. Nadagowda, sir, and also all in support of all the faculty members and the hosting committee. Today amidst us, we have Ms. Deepika Narayan Bharadwaj, who is well-known journalist, a documentary filmmaker, and also the equal rights activist. In fact, we are all proud to have Madam here. So I first of all welcome her to this gathering here. And today, before going further on, without much more ado, so I would like to share the credentials of ULC. University Law College is one of the oldest institutions in Bengaluru, offering 5 years integrated course of BA LLB honors, along with 2 years of LLM. And we have also got the proud notable alumni, plethora of proud notable alumni, including the Honorable Justices of Supreme Court. It may be Justice R.V. Ravindran, Justice Santosh Hegde, Justice M.N. Venkatachala, Justice M. Venkatachalaya, and also including all the Honorable Judges of High Court and 2 former Chief Ministers, and also 1 former Governor, and all the various representatives, or if I may say so, the doyens of Bar, who are from our college, who form the proud alumni. So now I request our Honorable Principal, Professor Dr. Suresh V. Nadagowda, sir, to kindly have a welcome address, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Esteemed guest speaker, Deepika Narayan Bharadwaj, my esteemed colleagues, former principal, Dr. V. Sudesh, chairman and dean, Faculty of Law, Dr. N. Dashrath, and all our faculty members, chairman and members of the Alumni Association, dear students, research scholars, and invitees. Indeed, we are very happy to have a very dynamic person, Ms. Deepika Narayan, who has made her mark in Indian journalism, and she is also a documentary filmmaker and equal rights activist. We are really thankful to you.
Thank you, sir.
For accepting our invitation and gracing this occasion to address all of us. I, on behalf of Bangalore University and University Law College, extend you a very warm welcome to this program.
Thank you so much.
I also welcome our esteemed colleagues, Professor V. Sudesh, Dr. N. Dashrath, Dr. Satish Gowda, Dr. Jyoti Vishwanath, Dr. Chandrakanti, and all other colleagues, and also welcome the president and members of our Alumni Association, and all the invitees, students, and research scholars who have joined us online for this program. Welcome to you all once again. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your welcome address, sir. And now we shall move on with the introduction of our guest speaker on this occasion. Ms. Deepika Narayan Bharadwaj is not just the courageous Indian journalist, but also the documentary filmmaker and equal rights activist. She rose to prominence with her documentary, Martyrs of Marriage, in year 2017, and which covered about the abuses of criminal section 498A of IPC, and also various other sections which are supposedly to be in favor of women and which have been accused of being abused and misused by the women fraternity. and she graduated with BTech in 2006 and also did a postgraduate diploma in television journalism from the Indian Institute of Journalism and New Media in the year 2009. And after that, before that, she also worked in Infosys for the period of 2 years. And her first documentary, Gramin Dak Sevak, was a prominent film, documentary film, which won her the Jeevika Asia Livelihood Documentary Festival in 2009. And Ms. Bharadwaj campaigns against the false allegations leveled on men by women under various gender-based laws in India. For the last 8 years, she has written and spoken extensively on the gender-based laws in India and the impact of their misuse on people. BBC, in fact, featured her story as a part of their series, Asian Women to Watch For, in year 2017. And she supported the MeToo movement, which is supposed to be as a counterproductive of MeToo movement, where the misuse and the abuse of various sections 498A and the anti-dowry law were misused by at such instances. And as a result of this, the MeToo movement found the vociferosity of Madam Speaker. And now the Madam also advocates for the establishment of National Commission for Men in India, and which would deal with the men's issues and listen to their grievances. Ma'am currently works in making out a length, you know, documentary film, a feature film called as India's Sons, that captures the ordeals of men who are falsely accused of rape. And without further more delay, today's topic being the dowry and domestic violence laws, I request Honorable Speaker, Madam Ms. Deepika Narayan Bharadwaj, to kindly enlighten us with and also to envision us with respect with the thoughts and ideas on this topic. And before that, or if any of the participants have got any queries, I kindly request them to post their queries to our co-host Satyajit MS on the chat box below. Now, without further more delay, I request Ms. Deepika Narayan Bharadwaj to kindly address the gathering. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Rajat, for that introduction. Thank you. Good evening, Dr. Suresh sir. Good evening, Sudesh sir. Good evening to all the professors of University Law College and students who have kindly taken out time today to listen to this webinar. I'm really honored that I got an opportunity to talk to you all. I've been told that ULC is a prestigious institute, and like Rajat mentioned, there are luminaries that have graduated from this institute. So it's an honor for me to be talking to all of you today. Now, before I begin, let me first share that I am not a legal practitioner. I'm not a lawyer. Whatever I have learned in the last 8 years is through my experience of dealing with laws and understanding the impact of these laws on lives of common people. There's a lot of technicality involved in laws, but laws are made to serve a human purpose. And I have, through my work, tried to bring out the human impact of these laws that were made for a certain purpose. Like I've been introduced, I am an independent journalist and a documentary filmmaker. And since 2012, I have focused my work on bringing out issues that men face in India. And this aspect of my life, or this happening of my life, started with a very personal experience. Until 2011, I was the staunchest women's rights supporter that you may know of. I'm a very strong, independent woman, being raised like that and allowed to do whatever I wanted to do in my life. But I've always been empathetic towards anybody who suffers in front of me, and I make an endeavor to help them out. Until 2011, it was sort of for all, but after 2011, my sort of focus became talking about men, because one, there are very few people who talk about men. Two, there are very few people who understand that men could have a problem too. So let's get back to first to where I started from, and then I will bring to the discussion, topic of discussion today, that is dowry and domestic violence laws. So in 2011, a very personal incident happened in my life, where a marriage broke down in the family because of extramarital affair of the woman, and this happened very briefly within the marriage. And like we would expect, you know, mature families to deal with a situation like that. While we have very, holier perspective of marriage, and we keep a marital relationship on a very high pedestal, the fact is, in modern society and in changing society, extramarital affairs are happening more and more, and happening both by the husband and the wife as well. We usually are very, introspect or hesitant to admit that a woman could be at fault as well. But that's the reality of today, that there are a lot of women who actually fall out of marriage and have extramarital affairs, just like men do. But the consequences for both are entirely different. So in this case, this woman had an extramarital affair with a married guy, and this marriage was planned because they expected to continue their affair after the marriage as well. But since the husband's family got to know this, both the families sat down, and like I said, like mature people, they decided to part ways amicably, because that's exactly what the woman wanted. Now, after the first motion of divorce, like you would all know, there are contested divorces and there are mutual consent divorces. After the first motion of the mutual consent divorce, within 2 months, the husband's side receives an application from the court saying that the first motion has been withdrawn because it was the woman was made to sign those papers under coercion and pressure, and the real facts is that she has been a victim of dowry demand and domestic violence. 2 pages of absolute utter white lies were there in front of us, and when I read that, my first reaction, normally people do not understand laws too much. As common citizens of this country, we do not really know how police works and how laws works in our daily life. We are so occupied with everything. And being a journalist, although I thought I knew a lot about social issues, I never knew that something like this happens. There were absolutely fabricated allegations that her neck was, she was tried, her neck was strangled. She was asked a certain amount of dowry and she was beaten up. She was beaten up every day. She was not given food to eat. Of course, later on in my life, when I got into doing this work on a regular basis, I realized that these are template FIRs which are made in 498A. But at that time, it was horrific to read those allegations. It felt like, the world has come to an end, because the only thing that is going to happen for the husband and his entire family is jail. And for how long, we didn't know. But then, as a little strong person, I started researching. I started reaching out to people in my media fraternity, telling them that this is what is happening, and the husband family is being unfairly targeted, completely unfairly targeted. And there are evidences to prove, strong evidences to prove that all of this is fabricated. But to my surprise, whosoever I spoke to was very hesitant of, supporting the husband's side, because they were, one, scared. And two, what I was told was that, if you support the husband's side, then you're really, looked at in a sort of a negative view. And it is very difficult to support the husband's side, because the public support usually remains with the woman. And I'm sure all of you would be seeing it every day on a daily basis as law students, that socially and legally also, our empathy, our belief, our very strong sort of gut feeling always resides on the woman's side, majorly, if she says so that she has been harassed. And there are very few people who actually want to hear the other side. Even though the law, the legal, the jurisprudence is based on listening to both sides and then looking at evidences and facts and coming out with a verdict, what has happened over the last few years, several years in fact, is it has become really skewed, the public perception also and the legal sort of belief also. So when I realized that it is extremely one-sided, and then I started talking to people, if I may actually quote from this incident, a judge actually told one of the family members, a retired judge, that do whatever you wish or do whatever you can to compromise and strike a deal with whatever the woman is asking, because the law is so inherently biased against the man that it will take years and years for you to prove your innocence. And even if you catch your wife red-handed with another man, there's barely anything that you could do. So adultery, of course, that time at least Section 497 was there. Now even Section 497 is not there anymore. So no matter how much of emotional abuse or mental abuse a man goes through in a situation like that, this, where he has been cheated upon, the only recourse available for him now, of course, is a divorce on grounds of adultery. When I got to know about this, and of course the end of this particular episode was definitely a compromise, because that's what was told by everybody around, or we would be losing, you know, years and years of our life in the trial. Post that, the experience left a void inside of me, that how could we be so okay with injustice like that? How could we be okay with absolutely false allegations put forth in front of the temple of justice, and a person having confidence that nothing will happen to her, because she happens to be a woman and she can level any sort of false allegations, and there would hardly be anything that would done to her, even if she is proven to be a liar. That left an impact on me, and I started making Martyrs of Marriage in 2012. It got released on Netflix in 2018. It was there for 2 years on the platform. Now let me come to the topic of the day, the dowry and domestic violence laws. The Section 498A of Indian Penal Code deals with harassment of a married woman on grounds of mental cruelty or demand of any property, which we usually know as dowry. And there is Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act, which was passed in 2005. Now, both of these laws basically criminalize and quasi-criminalize any act of mental harassment, physical abuse, sexual abuse, financial abuse, and also verbal abuse, but only if it is perpetrated on the woman by the man. A man is not protected under these sections as of now in India. We are in 2020, and the basic thing like domestic violence is considered to be a very gender specific crime, and the provisions are available only for women to seek recourse. Now, one, there is the idea of protection of women, which I absolutely and strongly support. But there is another side to it, which is abuse of the dowry and domestic violence laws. Section 498A of IPC, of course, has 3 years of imprisonment if the person is convicted. Domestic Violence Act provides various recourses to the woman. She can ask for maintenance. She can ask for restraining orders, and she can ask for residence orders, and there are a lot of recourses available. But if such act was perpetrated by the wife or the female partner on the male partner, then he basically barely has anywhere to go. Martyrs of Marriage documents several of these instances where people were falsely accused under 498A and Domestic Violence Act, cases where the financial demands were too much from the woman's side. And if the man did not cater to her demands, he was accused of dowry. Situations where the woman had extramarital affair, and if the husband found out, then as a backlash to that objection, there was allegations of dowry and domestic violence. Basically, there could be anything happening wrong within a marriage, which is not at all related to any financial demands or domestic violence, but at the end, the result is a case on the husband under Section 498A of IPC, domestic violence, and various other sections which are available to the woman to seek recourse. Martyrs of Marriage, of course, documents several of these cases, and there are people who have committed suicide because of such allegations. The way a person deals with a situation like this is absolutely different. Some people are able to take it, but there are, just like we have extremely feeble women who are not able to raise their voice against injustice or harassment, there are men as well who sadly we call weak, but these are men who are polite, who are very respectable, who are dignified, and who do not find the strength to basically fight an absolutely horrific allegation like that. another perspective of dowry and domestic violence laws, which I feel is extremely unfair, is implication of entire family members. And this is one reason that I found sort of the major problem or major reason in cases where men ended up committing suicide after being falsely accused. When they see their families suffer, when they see their names of their old age father, mother, married sisters, married brothers, maybe their kids as well. There have been extremely bizarre cases where small children have been accused under 498A, or people as old as 92 years have been dragged in these cases. When men see their families suffer is when they tend to give up. Now, Supreme Court of India has also commented upon misuse of dowry, Section 498 of IPC, calling it legal terrorism, comparing it with legal terrorism under Sushil Kumar versus Union of India. And this happened in 2005. But we are in 2020, and on a daily basis, I continue to still see misuse of 498A and domestic violence laws. Martyrs of Marriage documents chronicles stories of Sayyed Ahmed Makhdoom, Manoj Kumar, Avdesh Yadav. These are several men who ended their life because they just couldn't take the false accusations on them and their family members, and they thought that giving up life would probably bring some respite to their families. Another issue that sort of comes in the same ambit, which I'm talking about, of course, the legal provisions. Our alimony and maintenance laws were introduced so that if a woman is destitute, then she be provided assistance. But what we are seeing today is absolutely educated, independent, and women who have actually worked and earned, leaving their jobs and asking for maintenance the moment something goes wrong in the marriage. And like I said, eventually leads to dowry and domestic violence cases. If a woman is incapable of earning, if a woman cannot stand on her feet, she should be provided assistance by the husband. But in cases where she doesn't deserve to be supported because she can support herself, I feel courts do injustice by pushing the entire financial support on the husband. To just give you an example, 3 years ago, I raised for the first time, I guess, that happened in India, that there was a crowd fund started to get alimony. And this was an extreme measure that I had to take for this man called Shiv Kumar, because he was partially disabled. AIMS had diagnosed him with cancer first and then tuberculosis. He was in wheelchair. And even in that state, he was sent thrice to Tihar jail because he was not able to give maintenance to his absolutely fully abled wife, who was capable of earning and in fact earning, but hiding the fact from the court. And he was being sent to jail again and again because he was not able to pay his wife. Eventually, we crowdfunded the alimony amount that she was demanding from him. And I rescued him after 10 long years of struggle. Even now, there are cases where in lockdown, there are men who have lost their jobs, who are not able to earn. They have their families to support, but they're bound by law to actually pay their wives. The reason of doing what I do is basically the core idea of jurisprudence, which is even if there are 100 guilty who walk away or left out, innocent should not be punished. Even one innocent should not be punished. But in my last 8 years of experience, I think what's happening in India is in zest of protecting women, in zest of doing something for women, which is an absolutely fair and right human spirit, we are actually punishing hundreds of innocent in zest of actually punishing the guilty who actually perpetrated crime on a woman. There are just so many men, innocent men, who are languishing in jails today. And the problem, the next problem actually, and the major problem actually, is these innocents suffer and then even when they are able to prove their innocence, there is nothing for them. If I go back to my personal experience, I would have been happy to fight a case, a wrong case on me, whatever it would have taken. But when a person gets to know that even after years of fight, you may have to eventually either strike a compromise or you will just be acquitted on benefit of doubt. So these years of suffering of a man and his entire family on trumped up charges, and then no matter how much of you fight, you end up sort of in a losing space. Why is this injustice being accepted and promulgated on a daily basis in our courts, in our police stations, in our system? If injustice has to be countered and tackled and addressed and recourse provided, then why should we be so biased in addressing all of these things only for women and not for men? There are different issues, of course, when we talk about harassment that men face and harassment that women face. Most of us have a fair idea of the kind of injustices or harassment that women go through, but most of us usually are oblivious of the wrongs that men are going through. I bifurcate my understanding of men's issues majorly into sort of four problems. One is absence of laws. Whether it's 498A of Indian Penal Code, whether it is Domestic Violence Act, whether it is section tackling stalking, molestation, outraging modesty, verbal abuse, financial abuse, sexual harassment at workplace bill, Section 376, which deals with rape, 354, maintenance laws, most of them consider only women as victims. Now, what basically this does is, and if I may actually come back to a webinar that Justice Hima Kohli of the Delhi High Court did during the corona pandemic, and she said, yes, there are cases of abuse of sections that are there for protection of women. But, you know, we are not yet there to talk about sufferings of men. So the question that actually comes to my mind is, when will we have a time when we will or we can start talking about injustices on men or sufferings on men? A PIL was filed, I think, 2 years ago in the Supreme Court asking for the laws to be made gender neutral. And the Supreme Court responded saying, where are the numbers? Now, the problem is there are no laws that actually documents any harassment that men face. On a daily basis, I share, those of you who follow my social media feeds, on a daily basis, I share cases of a man committing suicide because of harassment by wife or her family, a man being murdered by his wife because she, along with her lover, men being victims of domestic violence, either burnt or beaten up, abused, thrown acid or oil at, or various forms of violence. These numbers, these situations, these cases are not recorded. And hence, we would never get to know what's the extent of suffering of the men in the country. Now, because we do not have numbers, nobody wants to look at this case, look at these cases, because there are no numbers. There are no laws, there are no numbers. I once wrote an RTI to the National Crime Records Bureau because murder is highest form of violence. And I asked them if they have any records of men who have been murdered by their wives. There was none available with them because we do not then have statistics. So a discussion on this basically falls flat because there are no numbers. But one statistic that we have is the number of men committing suicide in India, and the number of men committing suicide because of family problems is huge. And that's the data available with the National Crime Records Bureau. Now, these are recorded as suicides. These are not recorded as suicides because of harassment, like we have harassment numbers for women under 498A or 304B. The third thing is, so there are no laws, there are no statistics. The third thing is misuse of laws that have been made for women, but there are so many innocent that are coming under its ambit. The major problems are long years of trial, long years of losing your job, losing your dignity, losing your social standing, losing your money. At the end, just getting an acquittal, a benefit of doubt acquittal maybe, and no compensation. There are laws that deal with false allegations. There are laws that deal with false accusations. But in how many cases have there been actually recourse for men who were falsely implicated like that? I don't know. I remember doing a case, in fact, two case studies that I really wish to discuss, and I will not take more than 10 minutes now. Is one case of Digamber Gaikwad. In fact, it was a decision by the Bombay High Court, which, one of the rarest cases, granted 10 lakh compensation to him because he fought for 8 years of a false sexual harassment at workplace allegation against him. And there was, of course, a molestation case filed on him as well. He proved his innocence at every level in the criminal court as well, and to the complainant, to the committee as well, which oversaw the case. And Bombay High Court granted him compensation of 10 lakhs, and the woman was supposed to pay him 10 lakhs. But I met him in 2017, and it's 2020. He has still not got his compensation. There's Section 182, there's Section 211. There are various sections to deal with false cases or false accusations, but there is no data available in how many cases that were false, in which Section 182 or 211 was invoked by the police and the woman was actually punished in those cases. We don't have any statistics. So false accusations, that's another form of injustice on men. And all of these situations, all of these combined, basically are leading to harassment of a lot of men in India today. And surprisingly, and one more case that I wanted to discuss is Vijender Kumar from Haryana. This man was falsely accused of rape and he spent 8 months in jail in a blatantly false case. Blatantly. The police knew that the case was absolutely fabricated, but because the woman had colluded with the police officer, she was able to put this man behind bars. He got acquitted and he got a compensation. Again, one of the rarest cases of 5 lakh rupees. This decision came out, I guess, somewhere again in 2016 or 2017. It's been 2020. That man hasn't got a single penny. In fact, what happened was that when the judge directed the police to give him a compensation of 5 lakhs, the police actually appealed against his acquittal. And now his now that appeal is pending in the High Court. And all of this happened because this man pressed for compensation. If we talk about recourse in these situations, the recourse is far few and in between. There are cases where some people do get compensations. There are some cases, in rare cases, where men do get some semblance of justice. But in my experience of documenting these cases for the last 8 years, I've seen horrible human rights violation, horrible harassment, horrible torture, and absolute treatment of these men with indignity by the system just because they are men. And there's a presumption that they are wrong, which is absolutely unfair. Talking about men's rights is absolutely not an easy thing to do in India, because a lot of people think that this work, standing up for men, for innocent men, a lot of people view this as standing up against women. Now, somebody of my nature, somebody of my values, I strongly believe in facts, evidences, and looking at a case irrespective of gender, because I strongly believe that it's not the gender that makes a person commit a particular crime or wrongdoing, but it's that person's behavior, and behaviors can be wrong in any gender. I've been criticized a lot. I have been bullied a lot. I have been challenged a lot when I started sort of making some impact through my work. There are people who have tried to stop my work by writing emails to the organizations that gave me platform. When I gave my TEDx talk in Mumbai, TEDx Gateway, people wrote to them. When my documentary came on Netflix, people criticized Netflix for giving a platform to a documentary like mine. But let me say this in front of all of you, since you're law students and you will eventually go into the courts and see all of this happening in front of your eyes. Everybody who's a part of the system, not everybody, but majorly people who have been a part of, who are a part of the system, I'm talking about judges, very senior, respectable judges, they have appreciated my work. Very senior police officers, they have appreciated my work. Martyrs of Marriage was shown in judicial academies as well, because they understand that this is an equally disturbing side of the same coin. And these issues really need to come out. These issues really need to be talked about, because it's not about gender or it's not about standing up against women, but it's about standing for the right. And I think that's something that gives me courage on a daily basis to continue doing what I do. My next project is India Sons, which is real life stories of men who were falsely accused of rape, spent months, years in jail, despite being completely innocent, got acquitted, and of course, not sure if got any semblance of justice. The reason I'm making a documentary on 376 in 2020, within 8 years of the law being amended in 2012, when I made Martyrs of Marriage, I think about 20, 25 years after passing of 498A, is if Supreme Court passed guidelines in Arnesh Kumar versus State of Bihar, or you know, Sushil Kumar versus Union of India, or Rajesh Sharma, 498A was meant to be a criminal provision that was meant to give justice to women who were battered and abused within matrimonial relationships. But today, the zest of law has been reduced to a bare provision that is available for compromise between husband and wife. Was that the intent of lawmakers? Did the law actually had efficacy of what it was meant for? And it gives me jitters to think the way the rape laws are being misused in the country today. My documentary brings out cases where rackets are now running in India, where gullible men are trapped and then intimidated, blackmailed with false rape accusation and demanded huge sums of money. And this has become a business. Then there are humongous number of cases where if the relationship breaks up, the woman can go and accuse the man of rape on false promise of marriage. To the extent that 3 years ago in 2015, National Crime Records Bureau started documenting this specific provisions, this specific filing of rape cases. And to the horror of a lot of people, I think so, the numbers of rape and false promise of marriage percentage to the total cases has gone from somewhere from 25%, 29% to as high as 50%, 75%, even 88% in some states. These are cases where Supreme Court, high courts have completely divided judgments. It's more on morals and subjective judgments than facts and evidences. And it's so much of chaos. Some court is saying this is rape. Somebody is saying this is not rape. There has to be intent. There has to be. So anyway, so all of these things are coming together within 8 years of the law being made so strict and stringent. Not sure if the numbers have gone down. Not sure if the real rape victims got justice. But the law is being abused. And I dread of a day when Supreme Court may have to pass some guidelines to reduce the misuse of rape laws. And that would be a very sad day. This all documentation is happening as a part of India Sons. Hopefully this documentary will come out by end of this year. And last but not the least, this is something that I say in conclusion of my addresses usually. While human behavior from the idea of a behavior that is from a man's side to a woman, and any actions or behaviors or his actions have been coded into criminal laws, there are barely any provisions. There are no provisions that code the same behavior if perpetrated by a woman into criminal provisions. We have based criminal jurisprudence through these specific laws to grant protection to a certain gender when the same behavior can be perpetrated by the other gender as well. Internationally, and surprisingly, even Pakistan has a gender neutral domestic violence law. Bangladesh, such a small country, 2 years ago passed a special provisions or made an amendment to their Dowry Act, bringing a special misuse clause to punish anybody who would file a false case with a very significant amount of fine and imprisonment as well. I'm not too sure if India lacks intent or will to actually come to the aid of people who are clearly victims of injustice. Last but not the least, my sincere belief is men are not collateral damages, men and boys as well. These days, young boys, in the last case, a recent case that I dealt with was of a young 18-year-old boy from Mumbai who was accused of molestation by a 43-year-old woman because she wanted her cats to roam around in the society when this boy was playing badminton with his siblings and some kids from the society. I've spoken to the highest authorities. Everybody knows it's a false case, including a minister who works vigorously for animals' rights. But this boy still has his name registered as a molester. This boy got 99.6 percentile in JEE. But since this allegation, all that he's doing is learning law. We are losing the force, we are losing the productivity, we are losing extremely talented, educated, intelligent men through these provisions. I'm not saying all, I'm saying a significant section, and this should worry all of us. This is not fair, this is injustice, and men and boys of this country should not be sacrificed or treated as collateral damages in the zest of idea of protecting women. I think that's unfair. And I think both men and women should stand up and raise their voices against injustice as strongly as we raise a voice for protection of women, which is absolutely needed, need of the hour. No matter how much we do, probably seems less every day with the cases that we see on a daily basis. But the stringent laws should not serve as a tool or a weapon to settle scores, vendetta, and this should not be accepted by the system because the consequences will be bad, not just for men, but for women as well, who are real victims of these crimes and face such abuse every day. Thank you so much for listening to me, ladies and gentlemen. I think that's pretty much from my side. I'm open to taking any questions.
Okay, thank you, Deepika, for your very informative and brilliant presentation based on your field experience.
Thank you.
And you have also advocated for gender-neutral domestic laws. Yes. And that's a good news message for the men who have suffered domestic violence.
Actually, the big problem is that there's absence of a platform. Like, there is a helpline that an organization called Save Indian Family runs, which is called SIF1. They get thousands and thousands of calls every month. So there's a need of a platform where at least you get to know that there are complaints like that, you know, have a committee formed. I mean, it is all in the capacity of the lawmakers to at least have a committee, you know, to actually have people write to them their complaints or what they've gone through and have some will to listen to these men who are suffering. Sadly, it doesn't happen. We do not have any commission, any platform where people could send these complaints of outright injustice, which is sad, I guess.
Yeah, you are absolutely right. Yeah. No, in fact, you presented it very well. Though you are not a lawyer, and you are pursuing a law, but no doubt you will become a very successful lawyer once you complete your law and join the bar.
Thank you so much, sir.
All the best.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for your indeed a very thought-provoking and a very informative lecture, and also exposing the nuances as to the exploitation which can also happen at the other side. I'm sure that there will be many questions which may pour in by now. And yes. Now I request Ria of a college to kindly conduct the Q&A, question and answer series. Over to you, Ria.
Thank you, Rajat. First off, it was an amazing session that you just held, ma'am. It was really enjoyable and informative.
Thank you.
And we have a lot of questions for you today. So if that's fine with you, I would like to proceed with the first
please,
one.
Please, absolutely.
Yeah. So the first question is from our senior faculty, Dr. Jyoti Vishwanath, ma'am. And she says, so before we talk about the plight of men, and how many men were not paid compensation, do we have, as a society, taken note of how many women were paid maintenance on time and how many women were paid compensation? So
thank you, ma'am, for asking this question. My only submission to ma'am would be, do we actually have to be in a situation of either or? Cannot we be in a situation of both? Because women not being paid maintenance is absolutely wrong, and a man being falsely accused, suffering incarceration, losing respect, dignity, and very valuable years of his life, and then getting nothing out of all of that is as wrong as a woman who who's deserving of maintenance not getting that. And if I may add, if the courts are flooded with absolutely unjustified demands of maintenance, which courts are, I'm not too sure if the women who actually need will get the right time to be heard as well. And I would like to share a personal experience. When I was showcasing Martyrs of Marriage in 2017, and I traveled to about 22 cities showcasing the documentary, and I met several lower court judges, metropolitan magistrates, and everybody, you know, who deals with cases like these. When they can handle probably 50, 100 or 150 cases on a daily basis, they have a backlog of 10,000 cases. So as much important it is to give maintenance to deserving women who are abandoned and who are victims of abuse, I think there is no doubt that men who are victims of injustice like that do deserve compensation as well. So it's not an either or, and I don't know, I'm not too sure, like I said. So when exactly do we start talking about men? When will that point come? For some people, it may never arrive, no matter what happens.
Thank you, ma'am. So the next question would be, ma'am, can you please
just give me a moment? Let this is a lot of sun.
Sure, ma'am, sure.
Yeah.
So the second question would be,
yes.
So the second question would be, ma'am, can you please provide statistical data to support your claim that there is an abuse of Section 498A as such? How many women have been prosecuted for false accusation under Section 498A in the last decade?
Okay, so when we talk about statistics, like I said in my session as well, gathering or getting statistics to support the idea that men are going through something wrong is actually the biggest problem. Now, since you are all law students, I'm sure you are well aware that while we have provision of a police investigation resulting into either a charge sheet or a final report filed as where they get to understand that there's a false case and that statistic is basically generated, the courts just have a conviction or an acquittal, right? So if you want me to tell you exact numbers of false accusations that have in police investigations varied from 9% to 13%, 14% as well over the years, acquittal rate under 498A in some states is as abysmal as 1%. Conviction rate in some states is as abysmal as 1%, 2%. Now, if we presume that all the acquittals, which is absolutely true, that every acquittal doesn't mean it's a false case. Even if we presume that out of these 70% acquittals, you know, 20% or 25% or 30%, let's assume, happened because of lack of evidence or something, and it was a genuine case, we still have about probably 35-40% cases which were probably outright false, and hence they got resulted into acquittal. So there is absolutely no doubt that there's a gray area on when we talk about false accusations. But if we talk about either rape laws or 498A, at least in rape laws now, the statement of a woman is everything. It's her testimony which is the most important thing. And even after that, if the courts are eventually acquitting the man, disbelieving the victim, the person who calls herself as a victim, then there must have been extreme loopholes in the case in the first place for the person to be acquitted. And 498A, like I said, the intention was to give justice to a woman who has been battered and abused. But all of us know what's happening with 498A today. Everybody knows what happens in a 498A case. The first step is to strike a compromise, and there's a demand of money. 20 lakhs, 25 lakhs, 50 lakhs, or maybe a smaller amount. Of course, there's a wide range of how these cases are dealt with in a very small town as compared to urban. But if we look at statistics, there is overwhelming abuse. And if that was not the case, there are several Supreme Court judgments, there are several High Court judgments where female judges as well as male judges have written down that these cases are being filed to rope in all the family members, the elderly who get harassed in these cases. There are people who have absolutely nothing to do with the couple being dragged in these cases, and eventually the legal terrorism part. So if the abuse wasn't that much, then I don't think the courts would have come to a situation of calling this legal terrorism.
Thank you, ma'am. The third question is, do you think women who falsely accuse men should be punished with fine and imprisonment?
I think absolutely. There's no doubt in that. Globally, if you see, false accusations are also dealt with very stringently, although there's a lot of leniency there as well, and it's a phenomenon across the world. But I don't see any reason. Let me give you example of a very recent case that 2 days ago came from Bombay High Court. A girl tells the court that she wants to quash the rape case against the man because he happens to be her boyfriend, and she filed a rape case on him because her family pressurized her to do so, right? The Bombay High Court accepts her plea and fines her with 25,000 rupees to be deposited to Maharashtra Police Welfare Fund. And if the woman doesn't give the fine, then the quashing of the rape case will be nullified and the man will be going for trial. So here's a case where the woman herself is saying that the rape accusation was false and the fine is just 25,000. And then the man would go for trial if she retracts, absolutely foregoing the fact that man was in jail on this charge for several months. Another example was from a Rohtak court where a woman filed a false gang rape case on a boyfriend and his friend. And then years on, they spent 2 years in jail. She got married, and eventually these boys were acquitted, and the case went in favor of the boys, and the court realized that this was a false accusation. The girl was punished. You know by why? By what? Asking her to stand for 7 hours in the court. So if this is an injustice, then I don't know what is. So just like Madam asked before, what about women who do not get maintenance? What about women who do not get compensation? It's an absolutely fair question. But to undermine the question, why don't men get justice and why shouldn't a man who spends 7 days, 7 months, 7 years in jail on a trump-up charge not get, you know, anything in return for destroying his life? To undermine that, I think, is absolutely wrong.
There are quite a few questions coming in for you today. So the next question would be, there are many Indians of the opinion that there's always been a myth that men, that a man is always the perpetrator and a woman is always the victim. So do you think our laws presently need to change because women are misusing the very law that was passed for their own protection?
Absolutely, absolutely. There is no iota of doubt that I think the idea is, the core idea is what kind of society we want to build for the future, right? The laws that we bring, the changes, the amendments or the jurisprudence that we practice eventually has betterment of society, I think, at the core of its heart, and punishing the perpetrator or the violent person or the person who has done wrong, right? And that's why we have laws to punish people. Now, if we are going to say that, you know, we will not punish this particular gender because this particular gender has been oppressed for so long or suppressed for so long, and we don't believe that, you know, somebody of this gender can perpetrate, how long are we going to prolong this notion? Are we going to live in the past, or do we want to build the future? Are we going to keep saying that women have been oppressed for centuries, and they have been? There is absolutely no iota of doubt about it. But we also have women today who are beating up guards, who are beating up police officers, who are banging their husband's head with balan, chimta, butting cigarettes on them. There was a viral video that came few days ago from Kolkata where the wife was butting her husband with cigarette butts. If it was a man doing so, the outrage would have led that man immediately to jail. But in this case, nothing has happened to that woman. I followed up the case for a while. Nothing happened to her. And there are so many cases that go viral. I think Amity case was another one example where the woman brought gundas to beat up the guys and then went and filed a molestation case on these boys. Today, yesterday, I got a call from Kuldeep, who was one of the accused in Rohtak sisters case. If you recall, these girls who beat up the boys in the bus and claimed molestation when they were actually blackmailers and everything. Now, this boy has proved his innocence twice. He has been acquitted by two courts, but still he got a job in the government, but he is not getting his joining because the senior officers are denying him the joining on basis because they had a criminal case of molestation registered against them. So the whole idea is, when would we want to move towards gender neutral laws? When will that, you know, threshold come where we would want to do that? In my personal opinion, the time is now. And I don't see a reason to wait for another 10 years or 20 years. I mean, how many lives do we want to just completely ruin before we actually wake up and do something about it? So I think the minimum expectation that I have really from the government is to at least make domestic violence laws gender neutral, because violence within homes is not really happening only with women. It's happening with men as well. Please have the strictest investigations to prosecute a man's case, but please have some platform to actually listen to these complaints at least. No, investigate as much as you want before you prosecute the woman. Unlike, you know, you punishing the woman, man immediately if he, you know, tends to do an act. No, investigate it completely. But at least have a platform to at least listen, because otherwise you'll never get to know how many numbers do we have.
So the next question would be, with the unfair power balance which exists in the present social structure, where women still face a lot of challenges due to patriarchy, how can we ignore this aspect? This may open a Pandora's box for men to misuse this provision. Women may face further subjugation if the laws are made gender neutral. And how do we avoid that?
So does this person want to say that let the provisions be the option of laws being misused, that provision be available only to women?
No, I'm
so assuming... If men will be able to misuse the laws, so that means women can also misuse the laws, right? So yeah. We are okay with, you know, a provision being misused by women, just because we think that they are subjugated and there's a power imbalance. To this person, my question is, are women single, lone person? No, a woman has a father, a woman has a brother, a woman has may have, and her father or brother or maybe mother may have a power balance completely in her favor. I get so many calls where the man does not have any power equation with him, but the woman has the power equation with her because her father knows somebody really senior period in the police, and that's why the man is thrashed left, right, and center. So the power balance is not just gender specific. Power balance can also be what kind of family you come from, what kind of a background you come from, and what kind of contacts you have, or you're able to push. So women are not working in silo. They also have people behind them or with them. And then there are laws as well. So yes, there's no doubt there is patriarchy, and there's no doubt that most of our systems and most of our courts have lesser females than males. There's no doubt about that. But there are laws to come in for assistance for females, and that is why the laws have been made. But to say that the power balance always resides with men, I think is a wrong notion. And I don't think that's any reason to say that the man can never be at the receiving end.
Okay. So the next question is, what would be your perspective towards a society which is more gender neutral, and what would your recommendation be as baby steps? What could we do?
I'm sorry?
So what would your perspective be towards a society which is more gender neutral, and what would you recommend as baby steps?
Okay. Before I answer this, I think I would like to share something that because of this sort of listening or provisions being one-sided, and on a daily basis, cases coming out where the laws are being misused and there's some innocent man or a boy who received injustice, and then people seeing these cases, of course, social media is a great equalizer in these terms. While men cannot take their cases to the police stations or courts, but social media is an equalizer, and these things are shared on social media. There's a lot of sort of anger, there's a lot of helplessness that is building, okay, in larger public. There's so many queries that I get from young men and women as well, because like, again, I said, women don't work in silos, men don't work in silos. Women have men, their family members or friends or somebody very close to them. And when they see them suffer, they also feel helpless, of course, just like a man would feel if, his sister or his mother was on the receiving end of injustice and she didn't get any help. So we don't work in silos. We are a part of society. We see everything happening in the society. So because of experiences like these that people are having, there's sort of a helplessness and anger as well, if I may call it, in some people, that why are we so biased? And these are not people who are misogynist or anything like that. These are people who are just rational men and women who are raising a question, a very genuine question, that why are we so biased? And I think if we have little more gender neutrality, especially because justice eventually served in the courts, when there are fights or when there is wrong happened with either a man or a woman, you go to the court, you go to the police to receive some kind of a recourse. And these cases, of course, then come into public conscience of what is happening here. So I think if there was more neutrality, there would be less chaos, there would be less insecurity, there would be less disbelief, there would be less distrust that I see simmering more and more between both the genders, which is sad, because for a healthy society, I don't think people should live in fear. If there are, I remember there's a very senior IPS officer, Mr. Amitabh Thakur, who put a, note outside his office that he's uncomfortable meeting a woman alone in his office because he doesn't know what he could be charged of. And eventually poor guy actually was falsely charged of rape, and the case against him, of course, was dismissed after a thorough trial. His wife was also implicated, and they're a part of India's Sons as well. But this kind of distrust and disbelief in each other, I think, is not healthy. And what can we do to take baby steps is something that I took about 8 years ago. Talk about it. Hear people when they talk, when they share, when men share or their families share their ordeal. Don't presume that they may be at fault. Leave your stereotypical mindsets a little on the side and try to look at in a holistic, at something in a holistic way. And if you see something wrong happening, then share it, amplify it. I am really, really happy that over the last 3 years, I don't know if it's because of my work, I don't know if it's because of experiences that people are having, but there are a lot of young law students who have reached out to me, who are doing research on the subject, who are reaching out to their own communities and spaces to hear such stories and to document such stories. It's a very, very long way. There's no doubt in my mind, until unless there's something really drastic that somebody does. But I've seen men leaving 23-page suicide notes saying the law is crippled in front of women. There's this case of Arvind Bharti, who in fact did law basically to fight his wife. And then he was falsely accused of rape. He eventually committed suicide, leaving a 23-page suicide note. Anybody can read that on my blog. And he wrote that you know, the law has become, you know, paralyzed in front of women. And he fought for 10 years for justice. And eventually he thought he did get justice when he was discharged from the case. But then she again falsely accused him. And he was put behind bars again. And then he just lost the zeal and he ended his life. So these kind of episodes are, of course, going to leave as strong a mark on people's psyche as any horrible injustice on women leaves. So people would definitely ask for justice, and all that you can do is to amplify your voice. Just like you amplify the voice of a woman who suffers, please amplify the voice of a man who suffers. We need to talk about it. We need to discuss it. We may need to talk about the possible solutions. And, going back to where the Q&A started, you know, it's not an either or situation. Let's talk about how we can make our laws more effective and make our laws give justice to people who actually deserve, rather than they catering to people who are using them as tools. And I don't think there is anything wrong in punishing a liar. So raise your voice. I mean, research, raise your voice, share these cases. And if a man comes to talk to you and share some problem, give a hearing, please. That's the basic.
Yeah. We still have a lot of questions, but I think looking at the time, I would just like to ask you if you'd be comfortable answering just maybe a couple more questions. If that's
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, I am absolutely fine.
So the next question would be, according to NCRB reports, on an average, every hour a woman succumbs to dowry deaths in India, with the annual figure rising upwards of 7,000. It's clear that dowry deaths are still very prevalent in India. So ma'am, according to you, what is the solution to this other than providing women with legal provisions which help them access justice?
Can you repeat the second part of the question? So there are dowry deaths and the numbers are still quite significant. And then what's the question, sorry?
So according to you, what is the solution to this other than providing women with legal provisions which help them access justice?
Actually multifold. But since I'm not a lawyer, I'm not a judge, I'm not too sure if I'm the right person to answer this. But in my limited understanding of what I've seen is, one, if possible, our investigation agencies or the investigation side of police force, policing system needs to be separate than law and order. You can't expect a investigation officer to be investigating all of these cases as well, and then doing other kind of duties as well, and being completely flummoxed with these cases, because then you would have very basic investigation, if I may say, not thorough investigation. And if the case is not watertight, it will not hold up in the court. So I think police reforms is very important. Judicial reforms is also very important. I mean, we amended the laws after Nirbhaya and we had fast track courts and everything to expedite these cases. But where are we now after 8 years? Are we actually having cases heard very quickly? So it all comes down to actually making the system work the way it is supposed to work. So judicial reforms have false cases thrown out of the courts, punish the false accusers, accept the genuine cases, lead in the conviction, punish the person who has perpetrated the crime. I think these are two things that in my limited understanding are extremely important. We already have laws. All that we need is absolute implementation of this. If there's anything more than this.
Okay, if all questions are over, you can conclude this issue.
Yeah. If I may say, I think particularly when we talk about dowry deaths, and these are absolutely unfortunate cases, although that's another thing, that there are a lot of suicides because of any reasons, like there are a lot of husbands who commit suicide, there are a lot of wives who commit suicide as well. But in a lot of cases, if it is within 7 years, it is recorded as dowry death. 304B is like that. But regardless of that, I think what we really, really need to warm up as a society is for parents to accept that divorce is a reality of today's time. And please don't let your daughter suffer in another home. If she's telling you that she's not happy, if she is being subjected to any kind of violence, a divorce is much better than she's suffering that. So I think it's important for the society as a whole to understand that marriages may not work, two people may not stay together. And because of that anguish, anger also, there's a lot of time it leads to situations of abuse. So before it reaches there, it's better to part ways.
Okay. So I think we have a few questions, but since
I'm available on dnbhere@gmail.com. I'm on Instagram, I'm on Facebook, I'm on Twitter. I think the highest number of messages that I get is on Facebook, and I'm not able to usually respond to that many, but Twitter is a very, very convenient medium for me to respond to queries. You can reach out to me on Twitter. You have my email ID, dnbhere@gmail.com. Yes, that's my email, Naman. Thank you so much for sharing. So you can reach out to me with your questions. Anytime would be more than happy.
So if any of our participants have any other questions, they can directly post it to ma'am there. And so we'll stop for the day with the question answer session.
Thank you, Shriya. Thank you, ma'am, for answering.
Last but not the least, just my last statement. And I am actually, I feel sometimes tired to say this, but then I repeat it again and again because it's very important. Justice is not an either or situation. Standing up for men doesn't mean you're standing against women. Or standing for women also should not mean that you're standing against men. So let's be neutral, let's be impartial, let's be open to looking at facts of cases, and let's be open to accepting that anybody, irrespective of gender, can be a victim of wrong, and standing up against that wrong is the least that we can do.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for spending your valuable time and answering all the questions cogently and coherently. We are very happy and delighted you, ma'am. And now I request Naman Vankatari to kindly render the vote of thanks. Over to you, Naman.
Thank you, Mr. Rajat. Well, living in the times where social media has become the new courtrooms of trial, in the time where plethora of pseudo-allegations, pseudo-hashtags express hate towards one section to gain momentum, and which is gaining momentum like a rolling snowball in the society, we are glad and proud that society has people like you, madam, who has the courage, strength, and erudition to keep the true meaning of Audi Altum Partum alive. Since you started off with jurisprudence, let me say this, that your application of prudence was more powerful than impactful than that of the term juris. I express my heartfelt gratitude and reverence to you, ma'am, for presenting your intellectual views. It was an honor to have you today.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Okay.
To all of you young men and women, boys and girls, if anybody bullies you for talking about men, never get bullied, okay? Because you are talking about justice for all, and you're not talking about justice for, or, you know, justice for just one person. So hold your grounds, never be bullied if you ever want to talk about men, okay? Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Also, so much.
Thank you.
I would like to express my reverence and gratitude to our patron, Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, our Honorable Principal of University Law College, Professor Dr. Sureshwi Nadagowda, sir, our Chairman of Department of Studies in Law, Professor N. Dashrath, sir, our esteemed members of the faculty, the Student Organizing Committee, whose efforts and hard work has been of high accord and has connected the University Law College and Department of Studies in Law to the nation and to the globe in the days to come. All the ladies and gentlemen who have connected us today on the auspicious day of Onam, thank you very much from the bottom of my heart and on behalf of our institution, University Law College and Department of Studies in Law. It is always a honor to host you. Keep in touch with us, stay connected. We shall update you about our further events in the days to come. Jai Hind, Jai Karnataka. Have a thank great you. Day.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Naman, for your vote of thanks. And now on this auspicious day, we shall conclude this session by now. I once again, at last but not least, as every beginning has an end, we have come to the end of the session. Now, my thanking Honorable Principal and all the faculty members and the organizing committee for giving me this opportunity of being as a master of ceremony today. I once again extend my hands of gratitude to all the participants and faculty members and our Honorable Principal. Thanks a lot.